Thank you, President, for accepting this invitation to be part of this panel. And we're going to start with Gloria Vaquero, President of EDP University, with her presentation. Excuse me, National University. Sorry, so many. No hard feelings, Gladys. This presentation will be in Spanish.
No problem with that. Good morning, buenos días. I'm going to talk about retention after Maria, so it's impossible I can do that in English. It has to be in Spanish. So, talking of retention for everybody, aquí, retención de estudiantes en las instituciones se ha convertido después de Maria en uno de los tópicos principales y una de las tareas principales de todos nosotros. Todos recordamos ese día, imposible olvidarlo, 20 de septiembre de 2018. Todo lo que ha ocurrido después de María, obviamente no vamos a hablar aquí de todo lo que ha pasado, pero un leve recuerdo de lo que hemos tenido después de esa terrible huracán. Y como nosotros manejamos tradicionalmente la retención en National University College y qué ha pasado después de ese evento. Nosotros tenemos este modelo basado en varios teóricos, entre ellos Tinto, donde trabajamos el área académica, emocional, social y emocional, más o menos equitativamente con diferentes actividades y con un énfasis en la resiliencia. Nuestros estudiantes son estudiantes de un nivel socioeconómico bajo, en su mayoría, y parte de lo que tenemos que hacer es trabajar con ellos esa necesidad de mantenerse fuertes y, a pesar de sus obstáculos, seguir estudiando. Como todos sabemos, la primera etapa después de cualquier desastre, cualquier situación de crisis en nuestra institución es trabajar la etapa de mitigación, que es identificar inmediatamente las necesidades básicas, ¿verdad?, de los estudiantes. Y tenemos problemas de vivienda, de falta de energía eléctrica en todo el país prácticamente, dificultad para accesar agua, medios de comunicación, y aquí el problema, ¿verdad?, todos que nos quedamos sin teléfono, sin internet, sin manera de comunicarnos, el problema de conseguir gasolina y diésel, conseguir comida, ropa, zapatos, ropa de cama, muebles, camas, mesas, sillas, materiales escolares, no tener internet. Estas necesidades no son las necesidades tradicionales con las que nosotros trabajamos. Surgieron de momento y en cantidad y en alcance nuevas necesidades que son las necesidades básicas que se supone que todo ser humano tenga cubiertas para poder estudiar, poder pensar, poder aprender. Nos encontramos de momento con unas necesidades nuevas para nosotros poder aprender. Una vez los rescatamos, los encontramos, los fuimos a buscar de diferentes maneras, ¿qué necesidades traen? Ya en una segunda etapa, nosotros comenzamos clases el 16 de octubre, poquito antes de un mes. Y tenían estas necesidades, no tenían quien le cuidara a los niños, los tenían que traer a la universidad, así que tuvimos que organizar centros de cuido inmediatamente con los mismos empleados para atender a los niños. Tuvimos grupos de 60, 70 niños en los recintos. Transportación, localizar inmediatamente guaguas disponibles para traerlos porque no tenían gasolina o se le habían dañado los autos. En las áreas inundables, aquí hubo personas que el agua le llegó hasta el techo y los carros los perdieron todo. Laboratorios, estudiantes presenciales y los estudiantes que estudian online, obviamente no tenían internet, le teníamos que organizar facilidades en todos los recintos nuestros y en otros sitios alrededor de la isla. Tuvimos que dar clases los fines de semana por la necesidad de controlar el uso del diésel en los salones. Y el apoyo emocional, y yo leía hoy un artículo esta mañana de cómo han ido aumentando los suicidios y cómo ya se está estudiando la relación entre los suicidios y el huracán, pues nosotros tuvimos lamentablemente un estudiante que se suicidó y dejó una nota, y en la nota explicaba cómo ella no podía tolerar más, no tener electricidad, no tener agua, no poderse comunicar, no tenía auto, tenía los niños, se desesperó. Y así no sabemos exactamente, no solamente cuántas personas han muerto después de María, sino cuántos murieron porque no pudieron manejar la situación. Así que tuvimos que aumentar los servicios psicológicos que normalmente tenemos, aumentarlos en los recintos. Muchos repasos, tutorías, arreglos para entregar trabajo, sobre todo los estudiantes que estudian en línea, que es uno de los temas que discutimos aquí. y suspender toda la gestión de cobro porque no había dinero, no había ni ATH siquiera para sacar dinero. Recuperación, nosotros pudimos recuperar una matrícula, 92% de la matrícula, las edades de los estudiantes que se dieron de baja están en este grupo. La mayor parte de los que se dieron de baja durante ese periodo fueron de adultos con niños y personas que trabajan, si se fijan, de las edades de 22 a 34, es el grupo mayor, y luego los de menores, principalmente porque no pueden vivir sin el celular y sin el internet. Para los jóvenes descubrieron esa dependencia que tenemos de la tecnología, que es buena, pero usted no puede depender de eso, no pueden estar sin el Facebook, sin el Instagram, sin ver sus amistades. Eso creó una nueva necesidad. Las regiones, perdimos, estudiantes se dieron de baja de toda la isla, pero las regiones más afectadas fueron la región de Río Grande y Carolina. Pues tenemos un recinto en Río Grande que estuvo afectado hasta hace poco, no tenía electricidad. Bayamón con un 28%, Caguas con 15%, Ponce 14% y San Juan, que son regiones, ustedes como vieron en el mapa, ese huracán entró por Yabucoa, salió cerca de Arecibo, así que esa región central todavía tenemos pueblos como Yabucoa, que está casi todo sin electricidad. ¿Cuánto pudimos recuperar de esa matrícula? Pues pudimos retener un 92, perdimos ahí un grupo de estudiantes. Estudiantes online, fíjense que la pérdida es mayor, la anterior era 8, aquí no se ve. Y es 12, estudiantes online, depende mucho, pues, obviamente, de su tecnología y de poderse mover a lugares donde pudiera conseguir un Wi-Fi. Recordaremos las vidas en los expresos, la gente buscando señales, eso nunca lo habíamos visto. El modelo de retención entonces nos cambió un poco porque tuvimos que aumentar el apoyo emocional y el apoyo ambiental para proveerles los cuidados, darles ropa, crear centros de acopio, organizar oasis para darle comida, literalmente cocinar para darle comida a las personas, darle agua. Todavía tenemos materiales en los centros de acopio, en todos los recintos. Así que de momento los empleados tuvieron que moverse a hacer otras tareas que no eran las tareas acostumbradas y se redujo el énfasis académico y social. Tuvimos que hacer un nuevo calendario académico y estamos todavía, ¿verdad? Y hasta agosto no se normaliza el nuevo calendario, y el aspecto social también se redujo porque se redujeron actividades que normalmente hacemos. Actividades de retención después de María, rutas adicionales de transportación, horarios extendidos para los laboratorios de computadora de noche, los fines de semana, vales para desayuno y almuerzo. Todavía tenemos estudiantes que dependen de un vale para ir a almorzar o a desayunar, vale que se le da para que vaya a la cafetería o el servicio que tengamos en el recinto, porque no tienen dinero para comer. Horario extendido de tutorías, principalmente los cursos de ciencias y matemáticas, mobiliario, localizar y con diferentes organizaciones conseguir muebles, camas, gaveteros, cunas para niños, gestiones que no son propias de la institución. Y yo sé que todas las universidades en Puerto Rico han tenido que hacer eso mismo, unos más en unas áreas que en otros, pero tuvimos que inmediatamente llenar esas necesidades para asegurarnos de que ese estudiante pueda seguir su plan de estudio. Efectos escolares para los niños, porque los teníamos allí, tuvimos que crear casi unos kindergarten en los recintos. Apoyo psicológico, lo mencioné hace un rato, talleres de emprendimiento empresarial. Nosotros normalmente tenemos una actividad que se llama National Bazaar, que le permitimos a los estudiantes hacer unas ventas y obtener un ingreso, pagar sus deudas, tener un dinero para ellos, y le damos adiestramiento para que empiecen a generar sus ingresos. Casi siempre traen productos de comer, artesanías, diferentes artículos, pues tuvimos que trabajar para que el estudiante, que si no tienes dinero, no tienes quien te lo dé, pues vamos a generarlo. Se convirtió en una responsabilidad para nosotros. Identificación y ayuda a estudiantes deambulantes. Nosotros tenemos estudiantes que deambulan y hemos descubierto algunos que le han sacado provecho a ser deambulante y no quieren las viviendas, porque ser deambulante tiene sus ventajas. Eso lo aprendí yo también con mis estudiantes. Tenemos dos en esa situación. Actividades de autogestión en los recintos para generar ingresos para los estudiantes. Actualmente, la retención está en 92 y esto es comparando con la población que tenía antes del huracán. La online mantiene una pérdida de un 15%. Y me parece que esto para nosotros ha sido lo más importante, porque yo creo que todas las crisis se convierten en lecciones. Hemos aprendido mucho. Y si no aprendemos, nos coge el próximo huracán y nos pasa lo mismo. Como institución, nos dimos cuenta que no teníamos un inventario actualizado de teléfonos, direcciones de estudiantes y empleados. Si voy a mandar una guagua con sonido a un barrio, pues tengo que saber dónde viven. Ellos se mueven y no necesariamente actualizamos cada término, las direcciones y los teléfonos. Evitar el uso de madera. Tenemos que seguir construyendo en PVC, en metal, en lo que consigamos. Yo tengo un recinto en Arecibo, enfrente del océano. Es un sitio precioso. Pero bueno, a Luzano le encanta el recinto también. Así que se nos metió allí. Inventario actualizado de recursos para reparaciones de emergencia, electricistas, plomeros, carpinteros. De momento no apareció un plomero, no apareció un electricista. Y no teníamos un banco actualizado de dónde conseguirlo. Si usted no atiende rápido el techo y le entra agua, los hongos nos crean un problema gravísimo. Así que de momento empezaron a escasear, y esto es bueno para todas las instituciones que tienen estos programas, muy pocos plomeros y muy pocos electricistas, muy pocos carpinteros, nos hemos quedado sin esos oficios. Inventario de recursos en la comunidad para vivienda temporera, preparación de alimentos, despacho de diésel y gasolina. Hay que tener una relación, una alianza con una gasolinera que me deje echar gasolina sin tener que hacer una fila de 4 horas o comprar el diésel sin estar todo el día en la fila porque necesito para la planta del recinto. Somos expertos en generadores eléctricos, cambiar aceite, medir la temperatura, cambiar filtros, todos hemos aprendido eso. Y sobre todo para, ¿verdad?, nosotros los presidentes que manejamos el presupuesto de la institución, una partida presupuestaria para actividades de mitigación y recuperación, incluyendo los seguros, porque todos tenemos unos seguros, pero nadie tiene un seguro suficiente, primero, para cubrir el daño que era tan grande, y segundo, las aseguradoras son lentas pagando las reclamaciones. Así que en mi presupuesto esa partida tiene que aumentar dramáticamente, porque me tengo que preparar en el futuro para tener entonces ese dinero separado. Y descubrimos en Arecibo que por lo menos una línea de teléfono análoga hay que tener, una línea fija de esas antiguas viejitas. Esa era la única que funcionaba. Y había que tener un teléfono viejito. ¿Quién tiene uno? Pues nadie tenía. Situaciones, ¿verdad?, que uno no las piensa de día a día y que nos cogen de sorpresa, pero que nos hacen reflexionar cuán preparados estamos cuando la tecnología no funciona. Y cómo nos hemos preparado todos para eso. Pero a pesar de eso, yo no digo que Puerto Rico se levanta, porque Puerto Rico está levantado hace mucho tiempo. Puerto Rico es un país resiliente y solidario. Nos enfrentamos a la adversidad de pie, levantados, luchando para que renazca una mejor sociedad, más justa y equitativa, donde todos tengan acceso a la educación y a la felicidad. Gracias.
Thank you, Dr. Vaquero, for this excellent presentation. Now we welcome Carlos Morales, president from Tarrant Community College Connect Campus.
Good morning again. My name is Carlos Morales. Good morning again. I'm going to talk briefly about the non-traditional student, knowing that in distance education, we support students from many walks of life, but also students with many life circumstances. I'm just going to go as quickly as I can because of the time allotment here. And the non-traditional and the traditional student, is reshaping the way higher education institutions are delivering education. The non-traditional student nowadays encompass the majority of the students in higher education institutions. What you see on the screen is a summary of the characteristics of each of those two groups. The traditional student is full-time, attends classes during the day and mostly live on campus, while the non-traditional student studies at all times, day and evening, and works part-time or full-time, and is always on the go in a mobile way. The main aspect for non-traditional students is that for them, completion is the goal, and three-quarters of today's students are trying to balance a combination of family obligations, job responsibilities, and school attendance. I call that life issues, okay? And it varies from institution and to institution, and also from person to person. The information below that is a comparison in terms of the time it takes students to complete a certificate. And again, this is based on the design, if you will. So it should take 1 year to complete a certificate, but most of them take 3 years to complete that. And that is if they are full-time. If they are part-time, it takes 4.5 years. The associate's degree, which is what the majority of the programs we provide at our institutions are, is designed for 2 years, but on average, students take 3.8 years. And if you are part-time, it takes 5 years as well. In this particular slide, what you see is more characteristics of the non-traditional student. There is a continuous growth on online and distance education students. The latest study by the Seaman Group says about 7, maybe 8 students taking online courses or programs. They are older adults, single parents, part-time students, and mid-career professionals. They are also delayed enrollees, wage earners, and continuing education students as well. The student trend pretty much is as follows, and this is data from 2016. You see the ages in which represent the enrollment of students in online courses and programs. The particular data for the campus that I lead, which is TCC Connect Campus, is an online campus and in Fort Worth, Texas, a fully online campus. You see here the district is equivalent to a system, and you see the age group in which 45% for our students is over 21 years old, and then the age group for the Connect Campus as well. One of the important elements of a non-traditional student and also an organization is to capitalize on the motivation on education, and many students in non-traditional institutions focus on the career and the job and vision as the primary drivers for them to attend a college. Transition to a new career for many of them is the next step after graduation, and also seeking a promotion and a new position. In the particular case of Fort Worth, which is in North Texas, we have seen a flurry of relocations of corporate headquarters. Toyota recently moved to the area, moving 4,000 employees. Other national companies are moving there. So it's a combination of need and then retooling and retraining for many citizens, if you will. We are trying, and this is pretty much what I said here, trying to align industry with educational requirements. The online, I tease some of my colleagues, and I say that my campus opens at midnight, okay, as opposed to a face-to-face campus in which is limited because of the times of the days and the physical facilities. But we are open 24/7, and it allows students to manage the work life and the regular life issues with their education. And you see, you know, the technological changes are the main reason for employers to look for a more formal education. You have seen a recent increase in MOOCs, okay, in badges, is more accepted now, and students are shopping around in terms of where they will obtain their higher education credentials, if you will. The flexible and accelerated options is what drive non-traditional students, if you will. They look for flexible class schedules is at their time, at their location is when they want to do it, of course. The length of time it takes to complete the program is important for them as well, because they don't want to spend too much time. They have either bills to pay or goals to meet, and they certainly want that higher education credential as quickly as possible. And we have found that about 50% of non-traditional students prefer 8-week courses. That format is very popular for us. You see also the preferred format for non-traditional students. The classroom is always an option. The hybrid is increasing, but the online is the steady area of growth, if you will. You see the percentages here represented in a sum, all, and combination of the delivery of those online classes as well. I have a short video, and actually I will make it short, in terms of some of the testimonials from students. If the assistant over there can click on the black screen really quick.
If you're ever thinking about getting a degree and don't think that you have the time or the money or whatever, or things are too hectic, but that's not true anymore. Doing online courses really does work.
It just depends on who you are. If you need somebody to hold your hand the whole time, then you probably want to go to on-campus classes. Otherwise, online classes allow you to carry on a full-time job and go to school and be more successful, because I think you're able to focus a little bit more and you spend less time at it, because you're not sitting in a classroom for a couple of hours and then doing the same classwork. You're just basically doing the classwork.
I got 3 kids and a job, and that gave me the opportunity to continue with my job and also dedicate time for my kids and just work at my own pace at home.
Completing 2 semesters in college for the first time in my life was pretty accomplishing. Knowing that I can do it and actually pass it has been pretty insane.
Those are students from the PTK organization, Phi Theta Kappa, which is an honors program for community colleges, and that's the only virtual chapter of that organization in the state of Texas. Additional data here in terms of, again, a non-traditional campus, in a very traditional institution. You see here the females continue to dominate that aspect, both at the district, at the system level, and also at our campus, while males are a little behind. In terms of the enrollment, you see how we are managing those figures district-wide, if you will. The ethnicity of our campus, we are at 26%. Last semester we were at 24.5, which is an emerging HSI institution, and you know, heads, all those organizations. Certainly we appreciate the assistance as we serve more Hispanic students. The one important element about the modalities in the campus that I lead, we are only 2 modalities, e-learning and an accelerated weekend college. And now we are adding accelerated initiatives, and he's someplace there. David Pierce is director of that initiative, and he will be sharing some of the strategies we have been using as well. You see the programs and you see the student services that we provide for students. This is a chart that I used a couple months ago at a board meeting in terms of how we are doing. There is several sets of data. Here is the FTE equivalent, and usually that is the important figure for us, which is the online operations of the district are equivalent of, 14.35% of the total of students supported district-wide. Again, more data here, and as of fall 2017, we have 5,000 students that are taking a full online load, and that represents an 11% growth from the previous year. And then between 15 and 16, we grew 18% as well. Very quickly, and this is from the digital learning report, if you will. The growth of online learning continues to be one that is represented. However, in 2002, that was 9.6%, and you see that by 2015, in a short 3 years, it almost doubled to 15.4%. An important aspect that we need to highlight when we talk about non-traditional students is the success rate, okay? And the success rate is defined as students that earn A, B, or C, and for our modalities is 66.1% for e-learning, and for weekend college is 74%. There are several reasons for those percentages, and actually separate presentations that we can provide to you in terms of the reasoning behind that. Again, capitalizing on the aspect of the non-traditional student, the acceleration and the completion agenda, we have been exploring different options and additional modalities for our students, and we are in short terms, 8-week programs. We have an accelerated weekend college. We just started a monthly enrollment program, monthly starts. We have a May semester in Texas, which is between, you know, the spring semester and also June, and we just completed a winter semester. All of that with the intention to provide convenience, flexibility to students. This is a very busy slide, but this is again success in regards to an accelerated mode, and this is winter semester. It started December 16, actually 15, which was the last day of the regular semester, and it ended the first week in January, and all this happens online. Student support, enrollment, everything happens online because I told my team, listen, I don't want to be blamed for messing, you know, the holiday vacation of no one. So they managed to do this, and you see it's an 81% success rate as well. The monthly start, which is something we started in the fall, this is preliminary data, and it shows a 62% success rate, again, in the first 3 months of inception. All this is supported by student services, again, as a fully online institution. First of all, the accreditation agency, which is SACS, we are here in Puerto Rico from Middle States, but SACS require us to have equivalent services to students taking online classes. So, I mean, this is not a capricious request that I made to the board. It's something that I have to fulfill for my students, or if not, then we will not be accredited as a campus. And again, we will be with the panel for additional questions. So thank you again.
Dr. Morales, and now we want to welcome Dr. Antonio Perez, President of Board of Manhattan Community College.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
So let me just share a little bit about our institution before we get going. So as you can see, we are the largest undergraduate institution in the city of New York. We have about 27,000 students, and we have over 550 full-time faculty, another 1,100 part-time faculty, and we have 48 degree programs for our students with probably the largest enrollment in liberal arts, business, and criminal justice. A little bit of a breakdown of our students, as you can see, that 44% of our students are Hispanic, 32% are Black, 14% are Asian, 9% are White. The 44% Hispanics, the largest percentage, used to be Puerto Ricans, now it's Dominicans, which is not surprising in New York City. I'll share with you our 3-year graduation rates. It'll be a sense of what our initiatives have begun to bear fruit for us. As you can see, we have been moving steadily in the increasing of the graduation rates. We have loftier goals, but as you can see, for community college, that's probably consistent somewhere in the middle. The national average is close to 20, but we do serve an underrepresented population in New York City. Breakdown of our students, you have a sense of who they are and how they graduate. You can see that The Asian American students do significantly well. The African American students do the poorest of all the students. But look at, particularly of the Hispanic women. Hispanic women are the highest, one of the highest groups that we have there as it relates to, they have 20.6% of the, only second to the Asian American women. So our Hispanic women do very well as it relates to retention and graduation. We are very concerned about equity and inclusion within our institution. We try to create an environment which is inclusive and welcoming to everyone. And in order to try to prevent some of the performance gaps that take place, particularly among our black and black male students and our Hispanic students, we try to ensure that there's job satisfaction on the part of our faculty and our staff, because we feel that if they're not happy with the institution they're at, that they will not perform as well, and then us as our students will not be the recipients of the best education possible. So we try to remove some of the job satisfaction within the people who work at the institution to ensure that they're happy and are ensuring that they're providing the best service to our students. But we're also very focused and concerned about ensuring that there is diversity among our faculty and staff that reflect our student body. And we spend a lot of emphasis on that because they're in essence are the role models for our students. So we've been focused on that quite a bit. And we're trying also to make sure that we promote a sense of tolerance and understanding within our institution. We feel that it's not our responsibility to just provide the educational aspect of it, but how do we provide a situation where they are viable and responsible citizens of the world, and especially within the college and within the within our country. We've redesigned our development education. We find that about close to anywhere between 70 to 80% of our students require some aspect of remediation. And obviously, we needed to work more closely with the high schools to ensure that our students are ready. And we try not to put the blame on the students and say, well, they're not successful because they're not ready. Are we prepared as an institution to service and provide them the necessary skills and services to ensure that they will be successful? So we focus not on the students not being capable, but how can we, in essence, be a better, provide a better response to ensure that they will be successful, but working closely with the high schools to help them identify some of the issues and concerns that we find once the students reach our institution are very important. So we've also looked at ways of reducing the remedial sequences. So for example, we find that if a student comes in remedial math, we had, for example, 3 or 4 or 5 different levels of mathematics. So by the time they got to the second one or the third one, I mean, these were all non-credit courses for which they're paying tuition. So we tried to say how we combine some of those courses to reduce the amount of time that a student has to spend taking non-credit courses. We then began to look at, beyond that, how can we, for example, create co-requisite courses so that a student can combine a developmental course with some credit-bearing courses so they get some credit for what they're doing, so that they're not finding that they're spending the money and time for courses that don't count and there is no credit. Improving the use of technology for developmental students is very important. One of the things that I've developed on a personal level is I've been looking at remediation from a concern that why does a student have to attend a class in, let's say, algebra or intermediate algebra if a student finds that they've only missed the placement test by a few points, or if they failed the remedial course by a few points. So I created something personally with my own time and resources called Hidden Chalk, and this is a map, an app that the students use on their telephones. So I beta tested it this past winter session with students, and I was surprised at the results. 80% felt that the app helped them pass the course, and some students had failed the course 2 times already, and they said the app was what helped them kind of go over the top. But also, the amount of students that felt that they didn't have to take the course, that they could have done it by using just the app. And I'm gonna be improving the app for the future, but how many times do students have to enroll and pay for courses that carry no credit, and they really don't need the whole course? All they really need is a little bit of help. And our students spend so much time on their telephones, so this is why I created this particular app, so students can use their phones and do it independently. And I was monitoring their usage of it, and they were working on it at midnight at 1 or 2 in the morning. I was very curious to see what their learning and studying patterns were. But technology is very important for our students, ensuring that they're able to be successful and we can find other modalities for them. So we've expanded some very successful programs at the college. We have what we call ASAP. It's a national model that was funded by the City of New York and the mayor of New York City that will eliminate the need for students to pay tuition. They are selected on a competitive basis based upon the limited number of remediation courses they need. So we have certain criteria that are required for them to get in there, but they travel in cohorts. So they go from class to class together. And we found that that's been very successful in how they're able to help one another. Our program grew from, I believe the first group was a few hundred. We're going to be at next year at 6,000 of our 27,000 students will pay no tuition, be part of this program. They'll get all the necessary services. They'll get metro cards for the subways. They'll get additional support services, but they'll be taking their classes and cohorts together. We also have created something called the BMTC Learning Academies, also with the same idea. If you put students together, they're able to move in cohorts and they support one another. When they go into a classroom, people know each other and the faculty know them as part of being a particular cohort. So cohorts are very important for us in ensuring that our students will be successful and that they can monitor one another and be supportive of each other. I created something called Atom 2 back when Giuliani was the mayor of New York City. And he was very critical of the graduation rates. And I recall that he wrote an article and it appeared, I believe, in the New York Times. And I then responded back to the article arguing that he was wrong, that if students had financial resources, that that was really one of the greatest detriments, that if we can provide some financial support where our students don't have to work as much as they do, that they would be more successful. So he responded back something, and we got a little feud, and I decided I wasn't going to win that one. But I created this program called Atom 2, where if you're a student and you come to the college and your first semester, you're able to complete successfully with a grade point average of 3.0 your first semester, then you could be eligible for Atom 2. And that program requires you to sign a contract. And when you make someone sign a contract, it has greater validity than just saying, I'm in a program. The contract says that I will graduate within 2 years. And we find that our pass rate, the students are able to complete that within the 2 years, is 90%. Once we know that the 3.0 shows that they can do it academically, all they need is the financial support. So I've been able to get support from individuals to provide scholarship dollars. So every year I'm out there kind of hustling. So I'll take somebody out to lunch. And I remember taking this one person out to lunch, Steve Marigoff, and I said, Steve, you know, I'd like you to give us $375,000 for this particular program. And he said to me, he said, well, I like the idea. He said, but I'll do it if you can get somebody else to match it. So now I have to take somebody else out to lunch. But I was able to get Jay Lieberman. I took him out to lunch a month later, and Jay was able to match it. So we had $750,000. Now I have to go back and get this renewed. But it's part of what we do it as administrators within our institutions and as presidents of colleges, is try to find people to support us, because if you have a good idea, that people will support it, but you have to show results. Europe is another program, I'm not sure if some of you are familiar with it. It started primarily for high school kids, and this is providing students internships while they're in high school. But what we have in New York City is the year at the community college level, and these students are individuals who want the opportunity that when they're in college, that they're gonna do an internship, a paid internship. And so what Europe does is they partner with large financial organizations, and they have them pay $25,000 per student. Europe provides them the skill sets and the necessary tutoring to ensure that they then can be successful in a work setting. The students go into that work setting for 6 months, they get paid, now they have some real life experience. But we find that, you know, they come to school very differently than the other students. They come dressed to work. And the students come with that same mentality, and they get jobs right after they graduate. But I think it's so important that we provide our students that internship or experiential learning opportunity, because it's something that's valuable that they can use, and that then they can transfer it when they go into a work setting interview and say, listen, I not only went to school at a community college or four-year institution, but I have some real work experience. So providing them with that also is a factor that we find helps in the retention process for our students. We've improved our advisement program. If I tell you the number of advisors we've hired, we've been trying to break down the ratio. Thank you. We're trying to break down the ratio to about one counselor for about 300 students. Remember, we have 27,000. We have over 50 full-time academic advisors for our students. 50. And we also have within the cohort of the ASAP program another 40. You know, about over 100 people that are doing academic advising to our students. And that is key because, in essence, they work with the students in providing and mapping their future and how they will be successful. We are encouraging our students to take a full load, and a full load is not 12 credits to qualify for financial aid, it's 15 hours. We believe that if we don't challenge them, we don't put them on track to complete their college degree within the time frame that's allotted, that they won't do it. So we're trying to find a way of challenging our students to do that. We provide, for example, during a winter session we just completed, students that are close to graduating, we give them the winter session for free. We do the same thing for summer. We look for the financial resources to support our students to ensure that they stay on track and are able to graduate. And in essence, we work very closely with our continuing ed program to ensure that those students that are involved in our certificate programs are finding that there is a pipeline and a pathway in order for them to get into our credit-bearing programs and be able to graduate. I have a lot more, but I'll discuss that during our questions and answers. Thank you.
Thank you, President Perez, and we apologize for the short time, but we want definitely to have our last presentation that is going to be Dr. Omaira Caraballo on behalf of President Manuel Fernós, since he has a situation that he couldn't be here with us today, but he will be very well represented by Omaira, and Omaira's presentation will be in Spanish as well. After we finish, then we open the discussion with our moderator, Dr. Carlos Vargas. Go ahead, Omaira.
Good morning. It's a pleasure to share with you our best practices in distance learning. We hope that our experience helps you, and why not, help us to enrich all of our strategies to enhance our management for the benefits of our distant learning communities. Muy buenos días, es un placer compartir con ustedes nuestras mejores prácticas en el aprendizaje a distancia. Esperamos que nuestra experiencia les ayude y, por qué no, también nos ayude a nosotros a mejorar y enriquecer todas nuestras estrategias en nuestra gestión en beneficio de nuestras comunidades de aprendizaje a distancia. Como saben, la Universidad Interamericana de Puerto Rico es una institución privada sin fines pecuniarios de educación superior cuya misión primordial es la formación académica e integrar en las diversas ramas del ser humano, del saber humanístico, científico, social, empresarial y salubrista. Ejercemos esa función esencial vía tres actividades complementarias: la docencia, la investigación, el servicio a la comunidad dentro de un contexto cristiano ecuménico. Somos una comunidad dinámica y creativa donde todos asumimos un rol dual de educar y aprender los unos de los otros, profesores, estudiantes y funcionarios administrativos. De esa sinergia se generan los entornos propicios para la enseñanza, la investigación, la acción social, los estudios de campo, el análisis social y científico, la creación artística y la difusión amplia del conocimiento. Actualmente la Interamericana cuenta con una oferta académica de 308 programas aprobados por el Consejo de Educación de Puerto Rico, de los cuales 52 programas son totalmente a distancia, que incluyen 7 asociados, un certificado profesional post asociado, 21 bachilleratos, 21 maestrías y 2 doctorados. Esto evidencia nuestro compromiso y nuestro continuo crecimiento y fortalecimiento de la modalidad de estudios a distancia. Y más aún, valida que el ciberespacio es la nueva frontera fundamental en los esfuerzos de internacionalización de nuestra institución. Como una universidad centenaria, con más de 20 años de experiencia en la educación a distancia, con una oferta diversa y pertinente, afirmamos consecuentemente nuestra responsabilidad social y nuestro compromiso institucional como agentes de cambio en el siglo XXI. Toda esa gestión supone y requiere calidad en el diseño, contenidos alineados a los niveles de instrucción, una docencia que reconozca e incorpore la diversidad humana e intelectual, el diseño universal y una pedagogía liberadora y apotestante para ciudadanos mundiales. Cuando la virtualidad es el medio y el entorno, indudablemente se exige una evaluación constante y multinivel para analizar su efecto en el reclutamiento, en el progreso académico, la retención o deserción de los estudiantes. La educación a distancia no se contrapone de manera radical a la enseñanza convencional o tradicional. En cambio, ambas se diferencian precisamente por la variedad e intensidad en el conjunto empleado de recursos didácticos. Nuestra experiencia nos permite compartirles que la educación a distancia, al igual que la educación convencional, se rige por estrictos controles de calidad en la formación de profesionales. Es por esto que las instituciones de educación superior que incursionen en la educación a distancia deben estar conscientes de que no se trata de una alternativa más o de estar a la moda, por ejemplo, creando cursos o programas en línea como si fuera una evolución natural de aquellos cursos por correspondencia. Valga añadirse además nuestra responsabilidad en la validación constante ante las agencias que nos licencian y acreditan, ante el Consejo de Educación de Puerto Rico, demostrar la confiabilidad y susceptibilidad de las operaciones y la calidad de los ofrecimientos de la institución según establece el reglamento que rige el licenciamiento de los programas. Ante la Middle States Commission on Higher Education, quienes acreditan las instituciones de Puerto Rico, las instituciones de educación superior de Puerto Rico, asegurar el fiel cumplimiento con los criterios incluidos en las guías interregionales para la evaluación de la educación a distancia. En esta dirección será importante resaltar que las instituciones que ofrecen cursos y o programas a distancia tienen una gran responsabilidad de cumplimiento, incluyendo el garantizar y validar la integridad en todos los procesos que esta gestión universitaria exige. Por ejemplo, como requerimiento federal y de acreditación, según se contemplan en las guías antes mencionadas, y cito, las instituciones deben tener un proceso que establezca la verificación del estudiante matriculado, que este sea el mismo que participa y completa el curso o programa y el que recibe el crédito académico. Y como nos habló el colega anterior, y garantizar el que los servicios ofrecidos a los estudiantes presenciales sean comparables con la población que estudia a distancia. Y cierro la cita. Precisamente sobre este aspecto, modestia aparte, nuestra institución ha recibido comentarios muy positivos o de encomio sobre el rigor académico y los niveles de controles internos en la calidad en la educación a distancia en nuestra más reciente reacreditación. Validamos que existe un aumento significativo de los estudiantes que optan por tomar cursos en línea. Por ejemplo, vamos a ver si puedo moverme hacia la próxima clase. Necesito moverme a una. Vamos a ver si lo puedo adelantar en una próxima. Okay. Esta gráfica muestra que el 52% de la población estudiantil de nuestra institución en un semestre toma al menos un curso en línea, sobrepasando el porcentaje de los estudiantes que son totalmente presenciales. Datos comparables con los estudios que realizan año tras año Allen y Seaman para mostrar las tendencias de crecimiento en la educación a distancia en periodo de 10 años. De hecho, este estudio refleja un alto número de estudiantes totalmente a distancia en la Florida y Texas, datos que después de Puerto Rico coinciden con los nuestros, en donde tenemos la mayor cantidad de estudiantes a distancia. Compartimos con ustedes los siguientes mapas en los que se muestra la procedencia de nuestros estudiantes totalmente a distancia en un semestre del pasado año académico, reflejando una presencia mundial. Es evidente que la educación a distancia ha alcanzado una gran demanda y al adoptarse se asume con ello un gran compromiso diferenciado y casi diríamos a perpetuidad con los actores de todo proyecto educativo, los estudiantes, la facultad y la administración, por lo que ha sido, es y seguirá siendo fundamental la inclusión de la misma en los planes estratégicos de las instituciones. Es trascendental reconocer su valor pedagógico ante una sociedad cambiante y plantearse que es imperante mantener no solamente un alto nivel de calidad y competitividad, sino altos niveles de integridad institucional como una acción de validación constante. Nuestra experiencia ha demostrado también que el éxito de un programa de esta naturaleza requiere de la incorporación ineludible de estructuras y servicios de apoyo por áreas fundamentales, académica, administrativa y tecnológica. Estas deben permitir una administración programática dinámica, asegurando una relación estrechamente proporcional entre el crecimiento de la oferta académica, la cantidad de estudiantes, el desarrollo administrativo y el empoderamiento organizacional. No puede obviarse ni tampoco subestimarse la complejidad de lo que estamos hablando. Ciertamente incluye una amplia variedad de componentes que no son meramente extrapolables de la experiencia convencional, sino que requieren su propio diseño y desarrollo instruccional particular, el desarrollo de contenidos y multimedios, la adquisición y la disponibilidad de bases de datos bibliográficas y otros recursos para el estudio y la investigación, los accesos remotos, el apoyo técnico de las plataformas, la infraestructura tecnológica que sirve de medio, entre tantos otros componentes. Súmese a todo lo anterior que las distancias geográficas también suponen una diversidad en zonas de tiempo y por ende en horarios de servicio que llevan un servicio verdadero de 24/7. Evidentemente se presentan grandes retos y desafíos como ofrecer servicios de calidad, como les indiqué anteriormente, comparables con la presencialidad, validación y fortalecimiento continuo de la integridad de sus procesos y el replanteamiento de la visión, misión y los planes estratégicos de las instituciones educativas. Como líderes universitarios debemos ser entes cruciales en la transición hacia el cambio en los modelos educativos. Esto obliga a que haya una transformación que permita atender la creciente necesidad de formación educativa dentro y fuera de Puerto Rico a una población cada vez más diversa, en sus características como en sus intereses y necesidades. Dicha diversidad incluye una incremental multiplicidad de factores a considerar: generaciones, áreas geográficas, culturas, profesiones, niveles de conocimiento, intereses, idiomas, estilos de aprendizaje, vocabulario, entre otros. Por ejemplo, cuando hablamos de vocabulario, podemos ofrecer un programa en español. Sin embargo, el diseño de los cursos, el acercamiento de los docentes, deberá contemplar un contenido con términos más universales o el reconocimiento explícito de las variantes lingüísticas. Esto porque podemos hablar español, pero una palabra podrá tener diferentes significados según el área geográfica del estudiante. Finalmente, son muchos los retos a los que nos enfrentamos como instituciones de educación superior, pero al mismo tiempo estos nos presentan muchas áreas de oportunidad para fortalecer el sistema educativo de las instituciones de educación superior de Puerto Rico, las regiones del Caribe, Latinoamérica y el resto del mundo. Sin lugar a dudas, la educación a distancia es una inversión, una apuesta al futuro, que no solamente implica una infraestructura tecnológica robusta en constante actualización, sino del buen nombre y posicionamiento de una universidad con una visión estratégica y comprometida con ofrecer opciones de estudio emergentes y viables en cualquier lugar del planeta donde decidamos llegar. Realmente para nosotros ha sido un placer compartir con ustedes nuestra llave para tener acceso al mundo. Y en concordancia con este gran evento en el que compartimos nuestras mejores prácticas, con mucho respeto voy a entregarles una copia simbólica de la llave de la Interamericana a quienes tengo el honor de acompañar en esta mañana. Por supuesto, sabemos que cada uno de ellos ha creado, creará o modificará su propia clave de acceso. Muchas gracias.
Muchas gracias, Omaira. And now we welcome Dr. Carlos Vargas Aburto, Head Chairman, and he will be the moderator for this open session. The ladies in the theater have a microphone because we are recording everything. So if you have a question when he starts the session, please raise your hand so they can bring you the microphone and your question could be heard. Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much. I would like to thank the panelists for the very enlightening presentations that you made. I have a few questions here, and we would like for you to ask a few questions too. And of course, we have 10 minutes. So I'll try to be very quick. I'll just perhaps focus on one question per person here. But Dr. Vaquero, in Espanol? Okay. I'm just wondering, one thing that came to mind as you were describing the challenges that you were facing with Maria, did you have an opportunity to evaluate potential programs or degrees that you might be interested in developing at your institution as a result of the learning that you did. And I will say, one thought that came to mind was the idea of this entrepreneurship, emprendimiento empresarial, which, as you think, you talked about encouraging the students to develop opportunities to create some kind of income. And so I'm thinking that that is the beginning of potentially a program that you could develop in that area, unless you already have it. But I don't know whether other programs are coming to mind.
Sí, nosotros, son varias preguntas mixtas. Nosotros, nuestro principal programa de enfermería, acreditado por ASEM, y algo que empezamos ya a hacer es establecer contactos con otras instituciones en Estados Unidos, porque la migración está ahí y ha seguido creciendo, así que nosotros queremos que los estudiantes se gradúen con la posibilidad de conseguir empleo en los Estados Unidos o donde decidan irse, así que la acreditación programática se ha convertido también en una prioridad, más que más programas, cómo acreditar académicamente para que le dé más fuerza y más posibilidad a ese estudiante. Estamos en el proceso de acreditar también, y la visita fue en estos días, el programa de terapia de asistente de terapista físico, que cuando se mueve a Estados Unidos, si no está acreditado por CAPI, no puede trabajar, tiene que empezar a estudiar. Así que vamos a estar evaluando la posibilidad de ampliar programas que se ofrecen en educación a distancia, que como comentó el compañero, la mayoría de los estudiantes prefiere la modalidad híbrida. Pero si estás estudiando en línea y te vas a otro lugar, desde cualquier otro sitio puedes seguir estudiando, así que hemos mantenido parte de los resultados de retención tienen que ver con eso, que el estudiante sigue, ¿verdad? Sigue manejando eso. Y con relación a la pregunta del National Bazaar, nosotros tenemos varios programas de administración de empresas y como parte de ese programa venimos estimulando hace años a los estudiantes para que generen su propio ingreso. Y no me digas, no tengo dinero para pagar, no tengo dinero, no. Yo te voy a ayudar, tú pones una mesita ahí y vendes arroz con gandules y pollo guisado y tú verás que todo el mundo se lo va a comer, ¿verdad que sí? Calientito. Pues eso ha funcionado en nosotros, claro, es todo un proceso de manejarlo para que utilice parte de su ganancia para pagar sus deudas y le enseñamos a administrar lo que él genera para él.
Muchísimas gracias. Very good. So another one, quick one for Dr. Morales. I was very impressed with all the statistics that you provided about your institution. I'm just wondering, two questions here. One of them had to do with what are the employers of the students telling you about the kind of skills that they need and that sometimes people refer to as the soft skills. To be able to perform in the working environment. Do you have any kind of component like that, in your programs?
Well, actually, thank you for the question. One of the ways we have been addressing that is by developing a specific program that is competency-based for banking professionals. And this is very specific for our location in Tarrant County in Fort Worth. Which, you know, the tellers had some of the knowledge in regards to, you know, how to manage the transactions, but they did not have the soft skills in terms of customer service. So this program, which is tailored for the banking industry, is comprised of both elements, the technical or the knowledge part, but also the soft skills in terms of customer service, you know, efficiency, you know, expediency in terms of managing those transactions. In terms of the other part of the operation, the student services provide some of that, okay? The faculty also provides some of that. And we have developed an online orientation that also includes a component in terms of how to manage themselves, not only among classmates, because you know that happens through discussions, and you need to ensure how you write, and not only that is correct, but also the tone that you use in writing. You know that transpires to all these other elements of the soft skills as well.
Okay, very good. Thank you very much. So, I will move on to Dr. Perez. Actually, very interesting presentation. At Missouri, which is where I come from, we have actually this core requisite model for mathematics, and it's been tremendously successful. So I'm very impressed about the fact that you're also doing that. I was very impressed with the app that you developed. Did you do it yourself? Mm-hmm. Excellent. So we need to take a course. I love to do that. But then the other models that you talked about, the ASAP, the Learning Academy, the Island 2, those are really interesting programs. I wonder, you also talked a little bit about the reduced caseloads for advisors and advising. Could you comment on how is it that you were able to achieve that? How is that model working on?
Sure, it really meant how you use your resources. So we had to determine where we would make our investment. And we realized that the students who responded better in programs where they had direct access to individuals on a smaller scale than having to, you know, I think the national model in many community colleges is somewhere between a one advisor to 1,100 students, and we felt that that becomes an issue because students don't have that personal relationship. So we made a financial investment of saying that in addition to hiring full-time faculty, that we needed to supplement the support services, and we feel that an investment in academic advisor, because the impression that faculty will do it as well, we find is not the best model. Faculty aren't always very interested in doing it, and they're not always very proficient. So mm-hmm. we have special training for our academic advisors to ensure that the students are on the right path, that there aren't any mistakes, and they're able to complete their programs.
Okay. You had, if I understand, was that the Europe internship program that actually has been very successful for you? And I think you mentioned how that provides students an opportunity to really experience the working environment and understand what the expectations are, yeah. Perhaps even building on the soft skills.
But, you know, my concern is that as it's becoming very competitive in higher education to provide the students with the necessary skills. And I believe that those institutions that make an investment, providing students with internships and experiential learning, that then will be more attractive to students. Our students coming in are the new generation that are already volunteering in high school, already have some of that experience, and whose parents have been pushing them that you need to do something in order to get into the college. Now you're in the college, you need to do something in order to get a job. So I believe that higher education is moving into the trend of providing students with not only the academic skills, but also some of those opportunities to work in industry, work in companies, but then they have some real skill sets that they can sell when they compete for jobs.
Okay. Thank you very much. And Dr. Carvalho, in español, en inglés?
Podemos hacer un balance, ¿verdad?
Okay.
Ya varias en inglés, ahora en español.
En español. ¿Qué les parece? En español. Sí, presentación muy interesante. Una de las dos preguntas que me surgieron cuando estábamos, cuando estaba presentando usted su ponencia, era, uno, ¿cuáles son las... los mecanismos que ustedes han identificado para poder identificar al estudiante que está tomando el curso y tomando los exámenes o algo así? Y la otra parte tiene que ver con el tipo de entrenamiento que le dan a los profesores para que sean exitosos cuando dan cursos a distancia.
Sí, gracias. Bueno, la Interamericana ha pasado por varias fases. Como saben, les comentaba que llevamos más de 20 años en educación a distancia. Y hemos hecho diferentes procesos para validar la identidad de los estudiantes. Desde quizás procesos más manuales hasta procesos como nos presentaron uno de los colegas, ¿verdad? Que tenemos un remote proctor, procesos electrónicos que de alguna forma nos ayudan entonces también a garantizar que realmente sea el estudiante el que está haciendo la tarea y al que se le está calificando, que así es, más allá de que sea... un asunto de cumplimiento, también es un asunto de integridad institucional. En el caso de la formación de profesores, la Interamericana también ha ofrecido y mantiene una postura muy firme en que los profesores también tienen que ser readiestrados en esta modalidad. De hecho, científicamente incluso hemos probado que los profesores que han sido formados, que han sido capacitados en la modalidad de educación a distancia, incluso salen mucho mejor evaluados que profesores que quizás no presentan una capacitación de alguna manera formal en educación a distancia. Así que nos ha traído muy buenos resultados. Hay una cultura de capacitación constante de la facultad, además de políticas establecidas en esa dirección.
Muy bien, muchas gracias. Okay, so I am going to, if you don't mind, I'm going to make a suggestion here. We have a coffee break. And so I'm going to encourage you all. I think our speakers are going to be out there having coffee. So you can go there and ask them questions that you may have, capture them. Is that right? Yeah. Is that okay? You will kiss that way so you can have your coffee and at the same time have an exciting conversation. I want to say to you and to the speakers, really, the presentations are very interesting. I'm sure that you have lots of questions. I had lots of questions that I could have asked, but we want to balance the coffee break with the opportunity to talk to them. So help me thank them again for the presentation this morning.